Okay, guys, we'll turn this into a part three for our clutch assembly here. I want to identify a bunch more of these components here. And clutch basket, right? Inner hub. Thought it was missing. Just start, that's common that this sticks. And then when you move your parts around, you lose it. But here's the big thing. I know I talked about this once before, but we're going to do it again, okay? That bearing and bushing assembly in this clutch and in every single clutch has to be taller than this basket, okay? If it is not, when you torque this down, because now we're splined, now we're physically attached to the main shaft, when I torque this down, it'll physically lock these two together. Okay, they run completely separate of each other. So let me show what this looks like. With the washer in place, it raises this up, and now the back of this does not make contact with the rivets or the basket. Let's make sure we understand this too. When the engine is running, the clutch basket is always turning. It is not coupled, and let me prove this here. Let's see. Okay, I'm holding the main shaft, right? It's not rotating. And you see how the transmission is not turning, but my engine is.
Yeah.
Okay? If I'm attached here with my inner hub, would you agree with me that for this, if something is coupled to this, it has to turn the transmission?
Right.
Absolutely, right? So how we do that is with all the parts of this clutch, all these plates between steels and fibers, we're going to talk about how to check the clutch, how to measure it. This clutch is in terrible shape. See all the notches in there?
Oh, yeah.
Do you see how consistent that looks all the way around the clutch?
Yeah.
It's consistently screwed up. Those are supposed to be smooth as can be, just like they have a perfectly machined edge. Real common on dirt bikes and four-wheelers to be a problem. Okay, so how we assemble this is the hub itself, the back one, is considered a steel plate. You see that? Okay, that's considered a steel. Then we do a fiber, and we're going to get into a lot more detail on this. I'm going to talk about these steels real quick. You remember me talking about how they're made with like a big press that just punches these out? And there's some assumption that I have Googled YouTube videos like crazy trying to see how these are made. One side is rounded, and the other side is flat. When the press comes and punches this out, it rounds that edge. I'm gonna flip this over. And when I go here, it's a much more sharper or straight edge. Does that make sense? So there's a couple different, you know, rules on this, for example. Most people say flat's in. And most of the factory clutches I ever take apart, it seems like the flat side of the plate is in. Like if you work on a brand new vehicle that's never been taken apart before. But the common agreed procedure is that either all rounded side in or all flat side in. Does that make sense? So I'm going to stick to flat sides in, the flat side down, and that's the way I'm going to do it. For the first time ever in print, Harley Davidson at Skills USA a couple years ago gave an explanation on that, or didn't give an explanation, they gave a direction on this. And it was on the V-Rod where they talked about the plates had to go in a certain direction. But that particular engine had a push rod in here that lifted the pressure plate on and off. And it's really got us thinking about trying to look at the other manufacturers. You know, this one here, to take the pressure off, we pull it right here. On that V-Rod, it comes through the center of the transmission shaft and takes the pressure off. And they wanted the plates either rounded or flat side opposite the direction that you relieve the clutch. But rule of thumb, guys, I'm telling you, when you guys go read all of your service manuals today, there's no directions. They also don't even reference the flat or the rounded side. Okay, there's nothing in there. So I'm going to take a look at this again. I got a sharper edge, a round edge. And what I want you guys to do today too, tell me whether you can tell the difference. Okay, sometimes these plates, do you see how the lines are just straight here? Sometimes they'll be diagonal and you'll have like three plates that are straight, and then you need to put a diagonal one in. You really need a service manual to properly install a clutch. The other thing is with dirt bikes and ATVs, we're going to call these the fingers of the basket. Do you see how they're straight all the way down? almost all your street motorcycles, the very top plate has one offset finger. Okay? So you'll have a notch, and it'll only be deep enough for one clutch. The very top one will be offset. Did you ask why? I have no idea. It's an honest answer.
Yeah.
We've asked and asked and asked. Yamaha, unlike the R1, will, on their clutch plates don't measure any different. They seem identical. And they will have like I don't see if you could see this. They'll have a notch cut out here. They'll have a single notch. And the same exact plate will have two notches. And they will tell you to stack it up in a certain order, lining up certain notches. And you're like, why? It does not tell in the manual. There's no reference training. There's nothing we've been able to find. If anybody out there on YouTube knows the answer to these questions, comment in the comments below and we'll love you forever. Okay? You don't. I'll tell you what. You can put these together by any way possible. And what they say will happen is that the clutch will not disengage or engage as well. But the reality is how many thousands of miles does it take? And let's just use Sport Bike guys, for example. Would you agree that there's no way to have a certain expectancy of life expectancy of a clutch on a sport bike? How many wheelies does he do? How many burnouts do they do, he or she? We have to think that it's very difficult to put a life expectancy on a clutch dependent on use. You know, if you got that customer out there that babies it all the time and you know they baby it and their clutch lasts 3,000 miles, you probably put something together wrong. But the reality of it is we don't have this like really good consistent data to refer back to and go, geez, I should have put the flats in or the round. There's just nothing there. And it will fully function. If used the wrong oil, we'll tend to get into problems. Anybody have any thoughts on that or idea why? If it's not intended for a wet clutch of a motorcycle, it can stick and actually drag. And when these won't separate, because what's gonna happen here, when we put these springs on here and we press this pressure plate to squeeze this pack together, if we have the wrong oil in here, when you take the pressure plate off and create a gap in here so the steels and frictions aren't touching each other, the wrong oil can actually cause those to not want to separate. The pack will want to stick together and it will drag. You can have a bike that just sits for a really long time and the clutch pack will stick together. A lot of times what we do is we just take, shove the front tire up against the wall of a building, dump the clutch, it'll break the plates apart. And I don't mean break up as in shatter them into pieces. It'll separate that glaze and you go about your way. The other thing I want you to notice here is, did you notice how in this particular clutch, how all my frictions were grabbing the outer basket and then my steels grabbed the inner basket?
Yeah, good.
So that's the connection between these two, is between the outer and the inner. How do you know how many plates there should be?
Hartsfish.
Do you think you ever get into one of these that doesn't have enough plates?
Yep.
How about too many?
No.
Yeah, what'll happen is you can buy what's called an add-a-plate kit in the aftermarket world, especially for like dirt bikes. And what they do is they make each plate a little bit thinner so that they can add one more plate so that the overall separation between them, there's more surface area. So they'll literally take away enough material from each of like the seven plates, let's say, to make an eighth plate, and that'll totally screw you up because you'll get in here and you're gonna be like, wow, this clutch has too many plates. When it's fully assembled, if it's at the top here, you know, this pack right here, no matter how many plates are in here, you know, it's probably at the right height.
Okay, so how's that beneficial? Because you have the same amount. You still end up with the same amount.
Well, but you have more surface area because there's more steels and fibers to separate and then compress together. So your assembled height is the same, but when you take the real estate of a whole disc and add in that extra plate, you have more total measurable surface area.
So it holds better?
Yeah, they say it'll hold more horsepower. Is the big thing about it. We aren't near as concerned about, I wanna be careful with my words. With a clutch, it's got two functions, to engage and disengage. That's it, right? But typically, where are we more concerned with? Engagement, right? Because you know what? You know what's a commonality between motorcyclists?
Pilots.
This. And I don't mean full throttle, but we are on the gas more than we're off the gas. We're riding them, right? Okay, so, but we do want the clutch to be able to have the function of disengagement, and we want it to be smooth. We don't want to pull the clutch and have the bike jerk to a controlled place again. We don't want it to stutter through the stop. We want that to just be fluid, just as if it isn't even there. We're just, pulling it and engaging the clutch and releasing the clutch. We want it to be really smooth action. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Another thing we'll do is we'll put way thicker springs in to squeeze the pack tighter. The tighter I squeeze the pack, can I put more horsepower to it?
Sure.
Because here's what's happening, guys. You focus in on here again. And imagine this is all compressed with all my springs, okay, and this is squeezed down. What I'm doing is I'm trying to squeeze this pack so that this can't turn, because so that it can't slip, I should say. This is always spinning. It's always spinning. Engine's running, this is always spinning. But to get to the back wheel, if my back wheel's not moving, okay, and I were in gear and this clutch were bad, this would slip. It would sit and spin in here, okay? Hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If I pull the clutch and I'm in gear and these plates are bad or the springs are really weak, and I put it in gear, these will slip past each other and the bike just won't move forward. Has anybody ever been in a clutch that's bad enough that just won't accelerate? That's what's happening. They're still spinning, but they're doing this. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to show this. When you disengage the clutch, when you take the pressure plate off, and you relieve this pressure and the pack isn't squeezed anymore, here's what's happening is the main shaft is now not turning, but this turns. Do you see how I'm rotating the basket? That's a little awkward to do.
Yeah.
So this means the transmission is not moving. That's because you have the clutch pulled in. You can be in gear. It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be in neutral. You have the clutch pulled in. That stops this because the rear tire, the chain, the drag between the gears and this are just sitting there, and they're just barely, the steels and fibers are just barely dragging across each other. This is turning. This is stationary. When you put it in neutral, what do you do with the clutch? You let go. Now what happens to the inner basket? And so the transmission is turning, but there's no selected gears to the countershaft sprocket. So I'm going to ask you something. How many people would like their clutch to last as long as possible? Okay? I'm going to ask you. All right, so your hand go up. When you pull up to a stoplight, do you put the bike in neutral?
No.
Okay? So let's think about this. Now, I'm guilty too. So my hand's going up here. How many people pull up stoplight and hold the clutch?
Oh.
Especially if you ride a Harley or a chopper, they're about impossible to find neutral unless you shut the engine off. So about non-existent. So the majority of us pull up to a stoplight and we just pull the clutch, right? Look at what's happening. When you just pull the clutch, that means the rear tire is stopping the inner hub, and these are spinning and dragging across each other. So if you do a lot of in-town driving, would you agree that that person's clutch is going to wear a lot faster?
Yeah.
If you put it in neutral, they're squeezed. They're not spinning against each other. They're just rotating together as assembly. What happens to clutch life? It goes up. Imagine sitting at a train or something and just sitting there with the clutch, disengaged. It's building up heat because these two are they're separating away from each other just enough. When we disengage the clutch, here's what's happening. We need a good cutaway of this. They're just doing this. That's all the difference. It just moves about like that.
So they're just floating.
Yeah. Yeah, but they are touching, make no doubt about it. Yeah. So the oil we use is really important and everything else.
Did you say that BMW motorcycles have a single friction plate?
Yeah, they're just like a car. We've got a Beamer engine out there. They run, even the old ones. The BMW is all the way back into the, don't quote me if it's 50s or 60s or whatnot. They were an automotive style. They are an engine with a separate gearbox, and in between them is a great big old flywheel clutch. And the very first motor on the bench out there is a BMW, and the clutch on it's this big. It's on like a K100 or something.
Like a 10-inch disc?
Yeah. If big, I think that thing might be 12. It's huge. It's huge. Okay, let's keep moving forward on this. Once again, demonstration motor. I'm not going to torque this all down, but we are going to have some type of locking fastener, and I want to give you a tip on this. So this, well, it's actually got more edges it could be used. So it's been used on this side. I don't want to reuse this. You can see how wrinkled up the metal is, and we smashed it with a hammer flat. But when I go together with this, I'm going to set this on here. You guys, sometimes, you know, we don't have a lot of room in here, and I don't want to be bending against the clutch basket or trying to pry this up, because once it's in place and your nut is on, you know, once this is, you know, on, we're going to bend this over with a pair of pliers just like this, and we're going to bend the edge over once this is torqued to the spec. So do you see how, even though it's dinged up on one side, I got multiple other flats to use?
Right, yeah.
So this one is a multi-use washer. But I want to show you something here. What I like to do is, I don't want to be trying to get the lift, and sometimes you have next to no room in here. So what you want to do, okay, so I'm going to go to a vise here. I'm just going to grab a little tiny edge of this washer here. And the reason I brought my nut was to get an idea. I want to try and be a little more centered here, because I gotta be able to thread the nut down, but then I'll just take the washer like this and I'm gonna bend it a little bit, okay? So now, do you see how that's raised up now?
Mm-hmm.
Make sense?
Yep.
Because now it gives me a place to grab onto to bend it over. So it's just a little tip to make things a little bit easier, because man, this aluminum here and these fingers and these tabs, they are not pry points. You do not want to be prying off those. You will break those. So I'll go ahead and assemble this on here. I would torque this to spec. Do you bet that there's Loctite on here?
Oh, yeah.
You know, surprisingly, a lot do not. When they have this locking washer, a lot of times they do not require Loctite. So when they have any type of locking mechanism, it surprises me. Now, every one I was ever doing, I was always putting Loctite on there, and I realized I was just using Loctite where I didn't need to. So, boom, we get a torque wrench on. That's in place. Now, if you take a look at this, where I bent this up, I have something to grab onto to basically pull that over really nice and easy. Had I not done that, I would have to get punches and chisels to get it to lift. So, it's a cool little tip to go ahead and just give it. Did I give it barely any bend at all?
Yeah.
I mean, just barely any bend at all is what I used on that. So this would be, once again, torqued. We're down to our last couple of steps here. We're going to get our springs on. And I want to make a point here that, do you see how there's room inside of the clutch hub basket? See how there's a depth to it?
Yeah.
Okay. Look at the last fingers here of the actual, this is called the outer pressure plate. And do you see how it actually has fingers on it? So those have to engage. And the reason I'm saying this is there are some clutches out there that you can be off and it won't fully be seated, and it'll give you a false sense that everything's right. And how you'll know is you'll be able to take the whole basket and you'll be able to do this. You'll be able to lift the whole thing. Okay, so watch. I'm going to go ahead. I don't believe this one. Oops. Wrong way. I don't believe this one can be put on wrong. My springs go on this side on this here. Getting ahead of myself here. So do you see how the pack, when I suck, what I'm going to take that hub and I'm going to suck it up against this pressure plate. Make sense? So on this here, what I like to do is just a couple of turns to get it started. That's it. Something real simple here. I'm going to tighten them in a star pattern, but since I'm able to get it going here, go ahead and now we have to measure all of this. How easy do you think these tabs break off?
Very easy.
They really do. And what breaks them? Yeah, human error. Okay. Okay. Now this is a 5 millimeter and I'm not sure what the thread pitch is, but it's a 5 millimeter fastener. What type of torque do you think this is?
It's like
60.
Depends on the diameter of your bolt, but yeah, it's going to be small like that, right? 60 sounds reasonable to me. Did you already look it up on your Suzuki?
Yeah, that's
okay. And you had 5 millimeter bolts?
Yeah.
Okay. Think about that for a second. 60 inch pounds. It is going to be so easy to overdo that, okay? So
I think it's 42 inch.
Okay. Here I'm going to do it in a star pattern, right? And just basically keep kissing these down and making sure that that basket's engaged. This is not important right now. I'm just going to double verify right now. I'm going to look around the bench, make sure I don't have any extra parts because I'm really getting to the point of full assembly. And I'm going to look at my clutch cover here. This is going to engage into my rack and pinion here. Everything's looking good. I have no extra pieces, so I feel good about wrapping this up. Do you see about I'm moving that spring down maybe, a quarter of an inch or so, and then moving to the next one. These are pretty low tension. So I don't have a lot to worry about. It's not like, if it's the stiffer the spring, less bite for each spring as you tighten it down, okay? So one of my good friends, there was a student of mine years ago, and he was a B-class motocross racer. He'd done tons of stuff, and he said, so he went to go do his first clutch, and he knew, but he didn't think it was important to do these in a star pattern. It was on a late model YZ250F. And so he takes and he sucks one all the way down and breaks the boss off on the hub. And he goes, oh man, I'm dreading telling Shane about this. He told me to do those in a star pattern. And then when he found out that that hub was like $150 or $60, then he really learned his lesson. Makes sense? Here's what worries me more. What worries me more is that it doesn't break. What worries me is it cracks and then you don't know it. Does that make sense? That worries me, because when it broke, did it stop him to where he was like, I have to fix this? But if you get a false, or if you get a torque, it isn't even a false torque, but that tab that was inside there cracked and it just didn't fully break off, now it's going to break under load when the customer's riding it. And what that's going to do is it's going to ruin all of this, okay? So I want you to think about this. These five springs here are 20% of the overall spring pressure, right? 100% is all of them. So 20, 20, 20, 20, 20 equals 100%. When I break just one of these ears, that makes me have 80% of the force on this side, and it takes the whole clutch and it binds it.
Right.
Okay, what do you think that does to all the ears over here? What do you think that those steel plates that are on the aluminum hub, what do you think it does to the hub? That binds it really bad. And so the customer complaint is going to be, it's going to start off with the fact that it's dragging, and then what do you think happens next? It starts with dragging. Yeah, it doesn't disengage, Michael. So you know what I want you guys to do? When you think about a clutch not disengaging, you know, you need to think about somebody crashing. Okay, if you cannot remove power from that back wheel when you intend to, and you're out screwing around, I don't care if it's a motocross bike, a four-wheeler, or whatnot, your intention is to stop and you don't, you're going to have an accident.
Yeah.
I don't like to talk about this stuff too much, but it is a reality. Did you guys hear about the lady that died in Nebraska this weekend on a four-wheeler? 67 years old, I think it was. Her and her husband ran into each other. Yeah, and she was thrown from the ATV and died from her injuries. That was something just this weekend here, and I think it was in Oakland, Nebraska. This stuff is real, you know. I mean, what we do, it's pretty important that we put our attention to detail on our craft here. So that 40 pounds or whatever this is, that's for us, that's not much more than kissing. Does that make sense? This is a common one that entry-level guys will break off, and especially, don't go to this. You're going to twist that off. I don't care if it's a 6 millimeter or not. I remember breaking my first one on my race bike on my Ninja back in college, and I have never broke one since. That is a one-time lesson you'll learn pretty quick. There's our assembled clutch. If you guys remember this, this was part of our governor on this guy. And then when we assemble our clutch cover here, we're gonna lube up our seal here. We have dowel pins that this rides on, right? There would be a gasket in here, by the way, too. Something felt like it was binding on me. Okay, there we go. So once I tighten that down, now I can't go fully tight with this because it's meant to have the gasket in there. Does that make sense? So I want to talk about one other thing here. As you're putting this together, if it's binding on you too, you might have to rotate it around to engage the water pump. You remember how there was a gear on that one I just put in and it has to tab? Some of you are going to have a deal that goes like this. It's going to be like a knife and fork that has to engage. So you got to look at both sides, look at what you're putting on. Should you ever need a hammer?
No.
No, you don't need that at all. The next thing I'm going to recommend here is I'm going to look at my cover and I'm going to be intentional here. I see that I have two little dowel pins, very, very common on this because we don't want this cover to be able to move around, make contact with the spinning basket, right? So about every one of these, you're gonna see some type of locator on there. What we need to do here is I wanna kinda intentionally place, do you see how we have the rack here? Uh-huh. We're going to insert this in, so I need the teeth of the rack facing the right way to grab onto this. If I was here, is it ever going to work?
No.
No. Okay. Now, another thing that's just plain going to make this easier is getting some lube on there. Does that make sense? Now, watch what I do here. I'm going to get it eyeballed up. Okay. I'm aiming at my dowel pins, and then I just rotate this into place. Okay. Do you see how I just walked it in? So that's how we do that. I put my fasteners in, I'm gonna put my covers in, and guys, that's what we need to do our primary components.